So in previous class we discussed about the H parameter model of a bipolar junction transistor. Okay, let us start from that point. Can you see the slides? Can you see the slide? Student, okay. So, in previous class, we discussed about the small signal model of bipolar junction transistor, and we tried to develop an idea how the H parameter model of the transistor can be obtained. Okay, and that actually the model which is the small signal model that will get that will construct for the transistor, that model will be actually used in the amplifier design. Okay, so the H parameter for the any two port network, I don't know what is inside the box. Okay. Can be written in this particular fashion, where the input voltage and the output current are expressed in terms of the input current and the output voltage. Okay, that's why it is called hybrid parameters. Okay. So V1 equal to H11 I1 plus H12 V2, and I2 is H21 I1 plus H22 V2, and these parameters are actually extracted from the given circuit. Experiment is done, experiment is performed, okay, and these parameters are actually extracted. Okay, so these equations, if you look at these equations, actually you will know how these parameters will be extracted. For example, H11 is V1 upon I1. Okay, and from this equation, when we put V2 equal to 0, then only we can get V1 upon I1, which is H11. Okay, and V2 0 means we have to sort this output, two output terminals. Okay, so to obtain H11, the output terminals are actually sorted out. Okay, and similarly the H21 is I2 upon I1. So it's a forward current gain, output current divided by the input current. To find out H21 2, we have to sort the output terminals. Okay, and it is very much expected, because without sorting the two output terminals, you can't get this I2. Okay, because if the two terminals are open, the output current cannot flow. Okay, so H21 is I2 upon I1 when V2 is equal to 0, and H12 is V1 upon V2. It's a kind of reverse voltage gain. Generally, when we talk about the voltage gain, we say output voltage divided by the input voltage, but here actually we have written input voltage divided by the output voltage. Okay, so it's a kind of it's a parameter, it's a kind of measure that whether the output side is going to influence the input side of this two port network. Okay, if this H12 is very, very small, it means that the impact of the output voltage is very less on the input side. Okay, and to determine this, we have to set the input port open, so I1 equal to 0, and H22 is I2 upon V2. It's output current divided by the output voltage, so inverse of this is basically output resistance. Okay, and this is measured by keeping the input terminals open. Okay, so based on these equations, this small signal model is can be developed for this two port network. So we don't know what is inside this box, but by the experiment we got these parameters H11, H12, H21, H22. So now we can develop this small signal circuit model of this electrical network, okay, to carry out some mathematical analysis. All right, so it's nothing but you can see if you look at this model carefully, it's representation graphic, it's representation of these two equations V1 and I2. Okay, so V1 is H11 into I1 because I1 is going to flow through this H11. So V1 is H11 into I1 and plus H12 into V2. Okay, and similarly here I2 is the current, since two elements are in parallel, so the current that will be passing through these two elements will get added, okay, and that will be equal to I2. So I2 is basically H21 I1 plus H22 into V2, okay, this equation. Okay, so this how we develop H parameter models for a two port network. So this BJT can also be treated as a two port network, and here a common emitter configuration is taken, and we are taking the NPN transistor in this case, not PNP transistor. So that's why you can notice the different direction in the current. Okay, in this case the IE has to come out, IB and IC will go in the device, unlike the PNP transistor where IE was going into the device and IB and IC were coming out of the device. Okay, so similarly the H parameters can be written for the common emitter configured bipolar junction transistor with the help of these two equations, VBE, which is the input voltage, and IC, which is the output current. You can see VBE is the input voltage. So this is V1, this is I1, okay, this is V2, and this is I2. So I2 is IC, V2 is VCE, I1 is IB, and V1 is VBE. Okay, so thus these equations can be written in terms of H parameters. A VBE equal to HIE into IB plus HRE VCE, and IC equal to HFE IB plus HOE VCE. Okay, so V1, I2, this is I1, this is V2, I1, V2. Okay, so similarly the H parameters can be defined especially for this common emitter configuration. So that's why this subscript E is actually coming along with the another letter here. Is HIE indicates the input resistance for the common emitter configuration. Okay, it's input resistance for common emitter. Now this E referring common emitter. Okay, and I is actually indicating that parameter, means it's input related with the input. So HI means input impedance. Okay, input impedance when seen from the base terminal into the device. So HI is the input resistance, and it is VBE upon IB. Okay, so because in this common emitter configuration, VB is the input voltage, IB is the current going into. So the HIE is going to be VBE upon IB. So this is the impedance seen from the base terminal. When it is seen from the base terminal inside the device, then this HIE will be seen. Okay. And similarly, HRE is the reverse voltage gain. Okay. And HFE is the forward current gain. HFE equal to IC upon IB, so it's nothing but beta. Okay, IC upon IB we know is equal to beta. However, as since we are discussing the H parameters, it is noted as HFE. Okay, and HOE is the output admittance, which is IC upon VCE, and inverse of this will be the output resistance RO. Okay, and in the previous class I told you that this is actually used to take into the account of to consider the effect of which effect is considered with the help of ROE, HOE. Any one of you?
Early effect.
Early effect, right? The base width modulation effect. Okay, the slope in curve, slope in the current curve in the active region, active mode of the optician. Okay, very good. And for a common emitter configured amplifier BJT, when the parameters are extracted, a typical values of these parameters are you can see for the IC equal to 1 milliampere, HIE is 1 kilo ohm. Okay, it's quite large. Because HIE is VBE upon IB, and you know that IB is smaller, it's smaller than IB, IC and IE. So it will be because of this smaller base current, actually this HIE goes in kilo ohm range. Okay, so that's why you can see HIE is 1 kilo ohm, because the when someone looks into the base terminal from outside of the transistor, a high resistance is observed. Okay, so this is because of this region, because the IB is very small in BJT. Okay, HFE, HRE is 3 into 10 to the power minus 4. It's a very very small value. It indicates that there is no significant impact of the output voltage on the input side. Okay, and this can be removed, this source can be removed, and I can sort these two points, okay, to get a simplified model. Okay, if this were a higher value, I would also continue with this voltage dependent source HRE VCE. But this can be neglected giving this small value. HFE, current gain is 250. Okay, it could be anything between let's say 50 to 600. Okay, but for this experiment it was calculated as 250. HOE is 3 into 10 to the power minus 6. Okay, again if you look at the corresponding resistance, output resistance value, it is going to be quite large, okay, and in a few hundred kilo ohm. So large output resistance means that this element is going to draw very small current. Okay, and we can assume that most of the IC will be actually constituted because of this only HFE IB. There is very negligible current will flow through this element, and in that case this can also be dropped if the if the output resistance is such a large value. Okay, 1 upon 3 into 3 into 10 to the power minus 6 ohm. Okay, a few hundred kilo ohm, then I can drop this. Okay, and I can get a simplified model. Okay, which is actually shown here. Okay, this is the model of the BJT which is used for the common emitter configuration. So what you see, only HIE is there and HFE IB is there. So it's a simplified H parameter model where we have neglected this HRE VCE, HRE is very small, and also this output resistance is very large. So in that case this source can be shorted and this output resistance can be removed. Okay, so we will be left with a very simple model. Okay, which is like this. So here I will have this HIE, the input resistance and the current source HFE IB, okay, and this is IC, collector current IC. This is the base current IB, okay, ammeter terminal. So IE will be going out. Alright. So now with this circuit model, we can analyze an amplifier circuit. Okay, so here one example is shown, a common emitter amplifier circuit is given. Okay, and a common emitter amplifier is shown. So analysis of any amplifier has actually is a two-step process. Okay, so the first step is you go for the DC analysis. You carry out DC analysis, you forget about the AC signals, okay, AC input signal, and you look at only the DC source, okay, and the capacitors actually. When we are dealing with the DC source actually, DC source only, so it means that we are looking at the very, very low frequency, let us say that zero frequency, okay. So when the frequency is such a, when the frequency is so small, then the impedance offered by the capacitance is going to be quite large. Okay, omega, if it is zero, means Xc is going to be quite large. So the, when the impedance offered by the capacitances are large, we can remove these capacitors from the circuit for the DC analysis. Okay, so step one is DC analysis. Okay, I suppose that you have done this in your basic electrical sciences course. So I will not go into that. Okay, and the step two is basically the AC analysis. Okay, so in DC analysis, we don't consider the AC input signal. And also the capacitors are considered to be offering a very large impedance, so they can also be considered as a open circuited one. Okay, and under these circumstances, the DC currents through the different component resistances can be measured, and the quotient value, the let's say collector current and the collector emitter voltage, will be determined. Okay, and once IC and VC are determined, then we can go for the next step, the AC analysis. Okay, in AC analysis, basically the voltage sources, there are DC sources in the circuit, those will be connected to ground. If there is a AC source, that will be left open. Okay, DC source will be grounded. If there is AC source, okay, AC source will be, only DC source will be grounded. Okay, we'll use AC source and we'll see how the signal is going to flow from the input side to the output side. Okay, and we also consider for the AC analysis, we consider that the frequency is initially we consider that the frequency is quite large, and if there is a large frequency, then the impedance is close to zero. Let us say it's very small. The impedance offered by the capacitors are very small, so the capacitors will be short circuited. Okay, all these capacitors will be short circuited. This capacitor will short circuit this RE, so this will also not play any role in the AC analysis. Okay, there is a DC source, so this DC voltage source will be grounded, and DC source, if it is a voltage source, it will be grounded, and if it is a current source, it will be left open. Okay, but there is no current source in this transistor in this amplifier, so we need not to worry about that. There is a only AC source, DC source, which is VCC, so this terminal will be grounded. Okay, This CE is offering a very small resistance, so this terminal is actually considered to be connected to the ground. This will be connected to the ground. This RE has not to play any role because this is bypassed by this capacitor CE. So that's why this CE is also known as the bypassed capacitor. Okay, this will bypass the effect of this resistor RE. Okay, because this impedance is very small, so if there is a emitter current coming out of the emitter terminal, RE, if it is considerably large compared to this impedance offered by this CE, so all the emitter current would like to go through this CE only. So this will not play any role actually. Okay, so this terminal is grounded. Okay, so what we see that the RB1 and RB2, the two resistors are coming in parallel with each other, because this is our this capacitor C1 is shorted. So the input signal is given, which is AC signal, is VI here. So the input signal is VI, which is applied between the base and the emitter. So VI is applied between base and emitter. The two resistors RB1 and RB2 are coming parallel with each other, because the two other ends of the two resistors, this end of RB1 is grounded and this end of RB2 are grounded, and they are sharing this common node. So these two are coming in parallel with each other. Okay, and then we'll draw the model for this transistor. So this transistor is actually replaced by this box. Okay, so transistor has input impedance HIE and the output impedance HO is neglected. Okay, only output side we have HFE into IB, the current source, and this RC is actually this RC, because this is the collector node of the transistor, and with the collector node the RC is connected, this RC is connected, and other end of this RC is grounded. Okay, so this is a circuit model, a small signal circuit model for this common emitter amplifier, and we can use this to find out the input impedance, output impedance, voltage gain, and the current gain. Okay, for example, if you try to find out the input impedance, so from the input side, what we will see, the three resistors RB1, RB2, and HIE, these three are connected in parallel. Okay, so the total input impedance ZE is going to be RB1 parallel RB2 parallel HIE. Okay, similarly the output resistance in this case, from the output side, the only resistance seen is RC in this case, so the output resistance is going to be RC, Z0 is RC. Okay, if we are also considering R0 in parallel with this HFE IB, then the output resistance would be R0 parallel RC. Okay, and the output resistance would be Z0 is R0 parallel RC. Okay, but in this case the R0 is neglected. So the output impedance is only RC. Okay, similarly we can find out the voltage gain. Voltage gain is V0 upon VI. Current gain is A0 I0 upon II. Okay, so voltage gain can be obtained as follows. Okay, so here you can see the voltage gain is obtained. So V0, the output voltage here is basically the I0, the current which is passing through this resistor, multiplied by this resistance value, so which is I0 into RC. I0 is nothing but the collector current IC, which is HF into IB, so that is replaced by HF into IB into RC, which is equal to HFE. IB is HI upon VI upon HIE, So from the input side, we can write this IB. This is the base current IB, okay? The current which will pass through HIE is the base current. This is not base current actually. The base current will be this, IB. Okay, and IB, if the input voltage is VI, same input voltage is going to appear across this resistance HI. So IB is VI upon HI, that is substituted here. And then with the help of this expression, V naught upon VI can be written as minus HFE into RC upon HIE. Okay, so the voltage gain AV is minus HFE, which is actually beta, minus beta RC upon the input resistance HI. Okay, so larger the beta, larger the voltage gain we can get from this amplifier. Okay. And similarly, the current gain can also be obtained. Current gain is output current divided by the input current. So here the IB is first related with the II. Okay, so a KCL is Kirchhoff current division rule is applied here, and the IB is basically, there are three resistances in parallel, RB1, RB2, and HIE. So IB is basically the equivalent value of these two resistances divided by the total resistances, this resistance plus this HIE into II, and this gives us a relation between the base current and the input current II. Okay, and I naught is basically HFE into IB. I naught is the HFE into IB. As you can see here, this is the same I naught which is flowing. So HFE into IB, and IB can be substituted from this relation, and therefore we can have this I naught upon II, RB1, RB2 upon RB1, RB2 plus HI into HFE. Okay. So this is the current gain, okay, of this common emitter amplifier. The voltage gain, as you can see, that out of phase with, output voltage is out of the phase with the input voltage because of this minus sign. Okay, output voltage can be increased by increasing this. We can choose a transistor with high HFE, or we can also increase RC. And by doing this, we can play with the gain. But we'll have to also look at the another aspect of the linearity, whether some portion is getting clipped up at the output side. Okay, so that is actually is related with the design aspect of this problem. Okay, I'm not going into that, but there are many things actually. When you go for an amplifier design, you have to look at many things. You cannot change one of the parameter blindly, okay, for the sake of getting something. You have to look at the other aspects as well, okay. Otherwise you may face some problem on the other front. For example, if you are increasing RC, that will give you a large voltage gain, but on the same time it will shift the Q point on the either side of the load line, and one of the portion of the output signal may be eliminated, whether positive or negative. Okay, so it is not desirable. So we have to choose the value of RC in such a way that we get the maximum space for the output signal swing as well as the desired voltage gain. Okay, so that actually, when you study the amplifier design, the various aspects you will study. Okay, here only the purpose was to show you that a BJT can amplify a signal, and you can see based on this relation, we can get amplification factor, because HFE is quite large, and HI is, let's say, few kilo ohm. RC can be kept in the same range. Okay, RC, let's say HIE is 1 kilo ohm, so I can put RC equal to 1 kilo ohm, and if HFE is 250, I will get a voltage gain of 250, which is quite large. Okay, and similarly, the current gain can also be significant here. You can see that the RB1 and RB2 may be selected in such a way that the equivalent value of RB1 and RB2 will be even larger than HIE, and in that case, I naught upon IE will be close to HFE. HFE is, let's say, 250, so we can get a current gain of 250. Okay, so the good thing about the common emitter amplifier is we can get both voltage gain as well as the current gain okay, from this amplifier. So that's why it is widely used, okay, because both voltage and current gain can be realized through the by this amplifier. Okay, so now the discussion so far was focused on common emitter configuration only, but there could be a common base configuration as well as common collector configuration. And just like we build up a H parameter model for the common emitter configuration, we can also build up model for the common base and the common collector configurations. Okay, and the topology remains same. What you see that the input side will have one impedance and one voltage dependent voltage source. Output side will have a current source and the admittance coming in parallel with each other. Okay, so the models for common base and common emitter, common base and common collector are almost similar to that of common emitter. The only difference you will find is the voltage, input voltage, input current and output voltage, output current will change according to the configuration. For example, in common base configuration, the input voltage is VBE, input current is IE, because the signal will be given through the emitter terminal. Whereas the output current is IC and output voltage is VCB in this case. Okay, and similarly for common collector configuration, the input voltage is VVC, input current is IB, and the output will be taken from the emitter terminal. So output current is IE and output voltage is VEC. And accordingly, these parameters, H parameters, can be mentioned. The H parameters related with the common base configuration will come up with subscript V, okay, whereas the one with common collector configuration will come with the subscript C. So HRV, HIV, HRV, HFV, HOV, and for the common collector configuration it is HIC, HRC, HFC and HOC. Okay, and these are actually related, these parameters are actually related with each other. Okay, these can be, relations can be derived. Okay, however, I have just given you, I have just summarized those relations which actually relate the parameter. So you can see here the input impedance for the common base configuration, which was H11, is basically the input impedance of the common emitter configuration divided by 1 plus HFE. Okay, HFE is the current gain. And why it is so? Because let's say that the typical value of HIE is 1 kilo ohm. Okay, and let us say that the current gain HFE is 100. Okay, so under this condition, the HIB is going to be 1 kilo ohm divided by 100. Okay, so it's 10 ohm, 1000 divided by 100. So it's 10 ohm. So input impedance in common base configuration is much smaller than the input impedance in the common emitter configuration. Why it is so? Why the impedance seen into the emitter terminal, okay, in common emitter configuration is smaller than the impedance seen into the base terminal in the common emitter configuration? Anyone of you? For a transistor, let's say it is base terminal and this is emitter terminal, collector terminal. So when I see resistance from the base side into the transistor, okay, it is what is that? It is HIE. Okay, and when you see from the emitter into the transistor, it is going to be HIB. Okay, and HIB, as you can see, is HIE upon 1 plus HFE. Okay, so HIB will be smaller than HIE. Why it is so? Any one of you? Students, can you hear me?
Sir, because the current in base is less than the current in emitter.
Right, because the emitter current is much larger than that of the base current, okay? And for the same change in the base emitter voltage, the emitter current, change in the emitter current is much larger than the change in the base current. Okay, so that's why when you look into the base terminal, you see the larger resistance compared to when you see into the emitter terminal of a transistor. Okay, so in this way, actually, all these equations have some sort of physical significance. Okay, and you can derive your own these equations. Okay, and you can get a lot of information. But again, I will say that this is out of the scope of this course. Mainly, this kind of analysis is carried out when you go for the transistor-based amplifier circuit design. Okay, just for your knowledge, actually, I have highlighted these facts that there could be the H parameters corresponding to each and every configuration, and these H parameters are actually related with each other. For example, if you know H parameters of common emitter configuration, you can get the H parameters for common base and common collector configurations as well. Okay, so you have to perform experiment only once. You can determine in whatever mode you are going to use BJT, accordingly you can determine these parameters. Okay, and why there are different modes? Because the BJTs based amplifiers are designed in a different way. Sometime I will keep base as a common, so it will be common base amplifier. Sometime I will keep collector as a common, so it will be common collector amplifier. These amplifiers will have different characteristics. For example, you saw that for common emitter configuration, both voltage gain and current gain are high. Okay, whereas in common base configuration, the voltage gain may be high, but the current gain may not be as high. Why it is so? Because of this, you can see. The current gain HFB in common base configuration is HFE upon 1 plus HFE. So HFE is 100 and HFE is 100. So HFB turns out to be it's close to slightly lesser than 1. Okay, and if it is so, then you can't get a much higher current gain because there is a not significant current transfer happening. Okay, you see the input current is emitter current and the output current is collector current. So in that case, you are not going to get much current gain. Okay, because IC will be always smaller than IE. So this configuration could be good for the voltage amplification, and it also offers better frequency response than common emitter configuration. But the current gain, you won't get much. Okay. Whereas in a common collector configuration, you can see the input current is base current and the output current is emitter current. So emitter current is much larger than the base current. So you can get the significant current gain in this case. Okay, because IE upon IB is much larger than 1. So the order of the current gain in common collector configuration will be the same as that of the common emitter configuration. Okay, but the voltage gain you won't get. Okay, because the base collector voltage and the emitter collector voltage, okay, there won't be much difference. Okay, so the voltage gain remains 1 in this configurations, and that's why we also call it the emitter follower configuration. Okay, this is mainly used for the current gain. Okay, and as the voltage gain is close to 1, it is mainly used as a buffer circuit, which will isolate one circuit with the another circuit. Okay, so there are different configurations in BJT. All those configurations have their own merits and demerits, and they are actually used in certain applications. Okay, as I mentioned few, for detail analysis you have to go take up some courses which will be related to the amplifier design, and there you will discuss all those things in great detail. Okay. So this is actually the H parameter for the different configuration: common emitter, common base, and common collector configuration. Okay, so apart from the H parameters, there are some other model parameters which are also popular for the BJT, and these are actually noted as the hybrid pi model and the T model. These are actually simplified model, and these are you can say derived from the H parameter only. You can see that under certain approximation, the H parameter can be simplified to the hybrid pi model or the T model. Okay, so let us see how the simplified models are developed. Okay, so simplified models are developed considering the simplified equations. Okay, because you know that the collector current is exponentially related with the base emitter voltage. If you look at this relation, IC is A21 e to the power q v e b by k t minus 1 plus a 22. So this term is actually neglected, and this is a 21. It is considered as a is here. Okay, and in the active mode of the operation, since v e b will be much larger than k t, so this one can also be dropped, and we'll be able to write a simplified collector current expression in term of base emitter voltage in this particular fashion. Okay, so here you see IC equal to IS e to the power VE by VT. Okay, this term was actually neglected, second term, and also one is neglected compared to this exponential term. Okay, so if the collector current is written in this form, the emitter current, as you know, is IC upon alpha naught. Okay, which is actually yeah. Any question? Hello.
I will for last 2-3 minutes. So can so your voice cracked for last 3-4 minutes. So can you repeat what you said?
Which one? From here.
Sir, last slide, sir. Hybrid pi model. That one.
This one. H parameter for CB and CC configuration. Hello.
Next slide. This one. Next slide, sir.
This. Hello.
Yes, sir. This one.
Okay, I will come to that actually. Let us let me create some background first. Okay, then I will describe about that actually. Okay, so I was telling the simplified relations, current voltage relation. So the collector current is related with the base emitter voltage in this fashion, IC equal to IS e to the power VBE upon VT. And I am writing VT here because now I am considering VT equal to KT upon Q. So earlier this equation was written in terms of KT and Q, but now it is written in terms of VBE and VT for the sake of simplicity. Okay. And IE is IC upon alpha naught. So far we have been using alpha naught, but that is now replaced by alpha. Similarly, IB is IC upon beta. Okay, beta naught is actually dropped. Okay, so these are the three terminal current relations. The collector current, if it is known, if VB is there, from VB IC can be obtained. If IC is known, IE can be known, and if IC is known, IB can also be known. With the help of alpha and beta parameters. Okay, so now consider this circuit. In this circuit, what you see that the DC signal as well as AC signals are connected together. DC, when I have to, this is the DC source and this is AC source. Okay, so DC, when I have to write a DC quantity, I have to write the parameter in capital letter, and the subscript will also be in the capital letter. Okay, so this VBE refer to a DC voltage, VBE. Okay, if the parameter is written in small and subscript is also written in small, it's a AC signal, complete AC signal. Okay, so this VBE is an AC signal. If I write the parameter in small but the subscript in the capital, it means that I am talking about the instantaneous signal. So it could be a sum of AC and DC both. So that's why here you see the base emitter voltage, the instantaneous base emitter voltage between the base and emitter terminal is the sum of the DC as well as the AC signal connected between the base and emitter terminals. Okay, and this relation relates the collector current with the base emitter voltage. So here IC equal to IS e to the power VBE by VT. Okay, and this is the instantaneous voltage because I am looking at the instantaneous collector current. Okay, total collector current is equal to IS into total base emitter voltage divided by VT, and IS here E VBE is replaced by capital VBE DC value plus AC value divided by VT, and IC equal to IC e to the power. Okay, IC equal to here this AC signal equal to capital IC VBE upon VT. Okay. This is the instantaneous signal IC, and this one actually is there's some mistake here. Okay, it's wrongly written. Okay, so now from the above one, as IC capital IC is capital I capital C is IS e to the power capital VBE by VT. Okay, so in this equation, I can write IS e to the power VBE by VT as a capital IC. Okay, yeah, so this instantaneous current IC is the DC current IC multiplied by e to the power VBE upon VT. So it was written correctly actually, I couldn't understand it at that time. Okay, so this is the instantaneous collector current equal to the DC collector current multiplied by e to the power VBE by VT. Okay, now if VBE upon VBE is much less than VT, VT at the room temperature is KT by Q. So at the room temperature, its typical value may be 25 millivolt. Okay, so when VBE, base emitter voltage, and this is not the total base emitter voltage, you see this is the AC which is connected between the base and emitter voltage. So if the signal amplitude is less than VT, then only the approximation that we are going to do will be valid. Okay, so this equation IC equal to IS e to the power VB by VT is approximated as IC equal to IS 1 plus VB upon VT. So this exponential function e to the power x is actually written as 1 plus x. Okay, if VBE upon VT is much less than 1. Okay, so now this IC is DC IC plus 1 VBE upon VT. And now it can be written as IC into DC collector current plus AC collector current. Total collector current is sum of the DC collector current and AC collector current. And AC collector current here is from this expression is nothing but IC by VT, DC collector current divided by VT into VBE, and that is noted here as a GM into VBE. So GM is an important parameter, and which is noted as the transconductance. It is VC upon VT, IC upon VT. Okay, and you can see here why we are carrying out the DC analysis before going for the amplifier analysis, because we wanted to know the quotient value of the collector current, IC value. So once we know IC, we can find out this GM value, because GM depends upon the DC collector current value. Okay, GM is IC upon VT. It's very, very important design parameter for an amplifier. Okay, for IC equal to 1 milliampere. Okay, for IC equal to 1 milliampere. GM turns out to be how much if VT is 25 millivolt. Okay, then what will be the GM for IC equal to 1 milliampere? It is 1 milliampere divided by 25 millivolt. Okay, milli cancelled out. 1 by 25 ampere per volt. Okay, or it will be 1000 by 25 milliampere per volt. So 25 4, 40. So GM is 40 millisiemen. Okay. So as you will see later on that the amplification depends directly upon GM, and GM directly depends upon IC, collector current IC. So during the transistor biasing, we select IC, we choose IC. For example, if I need a GM equal to 80 millisiemen, so what I will do, I will choose IC to be 2 milliampere during the design. Okay, how do I choose? I will have to accordingly select the values of RE, RB1 and RB2. I'm not going into that, but I will choose IC 2 milliampere. The IC equal to 2 milliampere will give us GM equal to 80 millisiemen. Okay, and this will be further later on translated into the voltage gain. Okay, so GM important parameter, and it's IC upon VT, its value depend upon the quiescent collector current. Okay, and to find out the AC collector current, I need to know this GM and the AC input voltage. So this is a kind of linearization, okay, of the current equations. If the input signal amplitude is quite small, less than the magnitude of the thermal voltage, okay, at the room temperature, then the IC and VBE relations can be linearized. Okay, you see here the IC is exponentially related with the VBE, but if the VBE is smaller than VT, then the collector current IC is represented by this linear relation GM into VBE. Okay, so current voltage relation is linearized, so that the analysis will be simplified. So that's why we have been calling it a small signal model, okay, because we are looking at the circuit model when the signal amplitude is smaller than the thermal voltage at the room temperature. Okay, and in that case the collector current is which is output current is proportional to the input voltage. Okay, so we can also consider the transistor as a voltage controlled current source, because the output current is being controlled by the input voltage. Okay, so thus we can develop a model here, and the model is something like this. Between the output terminal, rather than having a current source equal value beta IB, okay, or HFE IB, now I will keep a voltage source. Okay, so this voltage source is current source, and this is voltage dependent current source, and its value is GM into VBE, because GM into VBE gives us IC. This is IC, small IC, and this small I, small C, the AC IC is equal to GM into VBE. Okay, whereas when we look from the base side, there must be a resistance seen, which is R pi. So in this case, although it is mentioned as a R pi, but it is nothing but it is equal to RE. It is HIE, sorry, not RE, it is HIE, which was there in case of common emitter configuration. This is same HIE, okay, because this was the emitter terminal, the base terminal and the collector terminal. This is again neglected in the hybrid pi model, okay. So this is R pi, and R pi is equal to HIE, and its value can also be determined, as you know that IC equal to GM into VBE. Okay, so we can get the IB. IB is IC upon beta, IC is GM into VBE upon beta, and we have to find out the R pi HIE, R pi, which is actually VBE upon IB. Okay, so you can see here GM into from this VBE upon IB, we can get R pi. R pi is basically beta upon GM. Okay, so if GM was let's say 40 millisiemen and beta let's say is 100, so the input resistance R pi is going to be 100 upon 40. It's around 2.5 kilo ohm. Okay, so this can also be determined. All right, so this hybrid pi model is basically a simplification of the H parameter model. Okay, only you call it R pi, and here the current dependent current source was replaced by current dependent voltage source. Okay, there is even an alternate model of this where you can see the input is R pi and output is beta into IB. This is same as that hybrid H model. Okay, the only thing was the R naught and this HR into C VC that was actually neglected. Okay, so these models are actually similar with the H parameter model. Okay, only the way the parameters are getting represented are little bit different. Okay, and however, you can simplify that circuit model, H parameter model under certain condition, and you can reach to phase model. This is hybrid pi model because it looks, I mean, it is quite similar to that of the Greek letter pi, so that's it's called a hybrid pi model. Okay, similarly there is a hybrid, there is a T model. So T model is look like the letter T, that's why it is called the T model. So in T model we have this base terminal and the resistance is seen with the emitter terminal in this case, not with the base terminal. Okay, and this is the collector terminal. So with the collector terminal will have same either a voltage dependent current source or a current dependent current source. The only difference is in place of R pi that was being connected with base in the previous case, here we are using the emitter resistance Re, okay, which is connected with the emitter terminal. And this Re is you can see VVE upon IE, which is alpha upon GM. This is only 1 upon GM. Okay, and the R pi was beta upon GM. So if you recall what I have shown you in the very beginning, how HIE and HIB were related, so you will just that will again make a sense here, because this RE is nothing but it is HIB. Okay, because now we are seeing the resistance from the emitter into the transistor, so that's why we are observing this RE here. Okay, so and if you also like to include the output resistance will be connected in this fashion. Okay, similarly here again the output resistances are connected. Okay, so these model you can get it from the from the H parameter models only, and under certain configuration, if there is for a particular configuration H pi model will suit more, for another configuration of the BJT T model may suit more. Okay, so depending upon which will suit better, have a better suit, and the analysis is simplified, the models are selected. Okay, so now at the end we'll talk about the high frequency hybrid pi model. So the high frequency,
sir,
yeah,
we have a lecture in 1 minute.
Okay, but there are still 2-3 minutes and I will finish this in 2 minutes. Okay, only I wanted to just highlight 1-2 things. Okay, so here actually in hybrid pi model, this was the model R pi GM VVE. Okay, at high frequency the parasitic capacitances become important. So between the base and emitter will have a base and emitter terminal will have a capacitance C pi, and between base and collector we have a capacitance C mu. Okay, so this C pi related with the base emitter junction. Base emitter junction is in forward bias, so C pi is a combination of the diffusion capacitance as well as the depletion capacitance, whereas this C mu corresponding to base collector junction, which is in the reverse bias, so this will corresponds to, this will refer to the depletion capacitance of the base collector junction. Okay, so let me finish this here. I will actually continue this in the next class. I will take some time and I will finish this, then I will start the next topic. Okay, thank you very much. And now you can leave and you can go and join your next course.